number 538 from the Mennonite community. 538, and I would ask you to say it as you know. Theme of love to God, the love of God, is a wonderful word which is in this song.
The ushers come forward for the lineup. I'm on a quote by Max Lucado. "Our prayers may be awkward, our attempts may be feeble, but since the power of prayer is the one who hears it, not the one who says it, our prayers do make a difference." Dearly Father, we're just thankful that we can gather this morning as a community. Thank you for your love. I just pray that you bless this service this morning and bless this time.
Thank you. Morning. Nice, beautiful rainy day outside today. I actually kind of enjoy sometimes when it's rainy out. Sometimes it feels like that's God's way of washing everything clean. So I don't know if you guys read what the titles of the messages are in the bulletin or not, but I titled it How He Loves. And that's just so that you guys can get a spoiler alert of what it actually, the story actually is. Because the spoiler alert's in the title, and it really is. Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. So there you guys have the story. Lazarus dies, he's raised back from the dead. So we'll see you guys. There's different theories as to why the story of Lazarus is only in the book of John. It's not in the other Gospels. And the book of John has a lot of different stories from the other Gospels as well, and there's different theories to that. The most logical of which is John lived to be quite a bit older than the other disciples, at least the ones that wrote the other Gospels. And so the book of John would have been written probably around 75 to 85 A.D., where the other Gospels were written somewhere between 50 to 60 A.D. So realistically, John probably had the other Gospels. He probably read through them, saw what these other guys wrote, and set out to write miracles and different perspective that was not told in the other Gospels. In John 20, I think this kind of maybe alludes to that a little bit. John tells us that Jesus did many other miracles in the presence of his disciples that are not recorded in this book. And another thing, too, that might have been why the story particularly of Lazarus was left out, in John 12, it tells us that because of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, that many people, because of Lazarus, were believing in Jesus and following Jesus. And so the chief priests set out to not only kill Jesus, but they wanted to kill Lazarus as well. So the other Gospels, maybe Lazarus could have very well still been living during the time that they were written, so they could have very well left that story out so as not to reignite the anger and hatred towards Lazarus and wanting to kill him, to kind of spare him that. So we'll get into the story now. If you guys have your Bibles, it's John 11. You guys can turn there. To kind of set the stage, Jesus had been in this area for a while, but he no longer was in the area. He had left. There was twice previously, recently, when he was in the area, that the Jews had set out to try to stone Jesus, and this is why he had left the area. We don't know exactly where Jesus was at the time. We kind of have an idea because it tells us that he was across the Jordan. And we know, well, roughly, if I actually look this up on Google, roughly, he was about a marathon's distance away from Bethlehem. And maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the average person would run a marathon in 4.5 hours. A little, give or take. But these guys are not marathon runners. They're walking, they're taking their time. So basically, they have a day's travel time from where they're at to Bethany. And so if you think about that, 26.2 miles, give or take, if you travel at 2.6 miles per hour, I think that's a fairly steady walking pace. And you also, this is a group of guys, this is not one person going from point A to point B. You guys know what it's like when you have a group of people, you got bathroom breaks, somebody's always got to go, they probably want to stop for lunch. And if you're a truck driver, then you got to figure in your pre-trip, your post-trip inspection, and your required half-hour break in there. So basically, you're looking at a 12-hour trip for these guys. And it tells us Jesus talks about that a little bit in verses 9, I believe it is, about how there's 12 hours in the day that you can travel, and I think that's probably what he's alluding to. Let's go ahead and read. I'll start reading in verse 1. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. Now the sister sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." So this here, Lazarus is sick, and I think the sisters are, you know how when you're sick and you're trying to wait it out, but when you get better, it doesn't get better, so finally you go to the doctor. I think the same thing is happening here. Lazarus is sick, and the sisters are kind of waiting out, and it takes a turn for the worse, and they realize, okay, something needs to be done here, go get Jesus. But as soon as these messengers leave to go tell Jesus, is around the time that Lazarus died. We can kind of do the math. You have a day's travel there for them to go tell Jesus, and a day's travel back. And we're told that Jesus waited 2 days before deciding to go back. And that 4 day span there is of significance, which we'll get into a little bit later. Verse 4, picking up. When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." So that right there tells me, and I've had this discussion with some people, whether Jesus, I believe God knows everything. He knows, like a year from now what I'm going to be eating for supper Sunday night. Jesus, I've read different theories on whether him being fully human, if he knew everything or not, or if he was simply fully committed, fully obedient to the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit's promptings that it led him to kind of have insight on certain things or not, or whether he actually knew everything. But this verse right here, he knows what's going to happen here with Lazarus, whether he knew that, whether he was prompted by the Holy Spirit or not. But it tells us also that this is happening for the glory of God, so that his Son may be glorified through it. Does anybody know where we heard that before? Two weeks ago, Steve shared with us about a man being born blind, and he was born blind so that God may be glorified through him. This creates a little bit of a dilemma for me, because I kind of use that as with my struggles, or any struggles in particular, there's a purpose for it, there's a reason for it, which, it doesn't make me say, "Hey, Greg, you know what, I'm going to have a struggle because there's four and it's going to go if I got it." I still don't want to go through it. But it does give it a purpose, which maybe helps a little bit, I don't know. Alright, let me pick back up again here. Jump ahead to verse 7. Then he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago, the Jews tried to stone you, and yet you are going back there." Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees by the world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, and he has no light." I think there I mentioned that Jesus, I think, was alluded to that's how long it would take them. They had 12 hours to travel. But also this, I think we can take this spiritually as well. If we walk in the light of Jesus, we have his light, so we don't stumble. When we walk in darkness, we're bound to fall. Verse 11, after he had said this, he he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." I find it really interesting the disciples' response here when Jesus says, you know, he's asleep and we need to go wake him up. If anybody watches Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood, rest is best. So they're like, "Hey, let the man sleep. That's what he needs. He's going to get better." Then Jesus plainly says to him, "No, he died." Verse 16, "Then Thomas, called Didymus, which means twin, said to the rest of the disciples, 'Let us go, that we may die with him.'" I can't help but feel like there's some sarcasm in that. And this would have been particularly dangerous for Thomas, who he's called twin because it's believed that he looked a lot like Jesus. And if they were out to stone Jesus, this is going to be particularly dangerous for Thomas to be back in the area. But some people believe that by him saying, let's go and die with him, shows his devotion to Jesus and his courage to follow Jesus wherever he goes. So you can use your judgment there whether that's the case or whether he's just being sarcastic and being like, "Hey, we're going to die, we got nothing better to do, let's go do it." Back up here, verse 17. "On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. 'Lord,' Martha said to Jesus, 'if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask.'" Now, Martha, if you remember from the story where Jesus was there to eat, and Martha was the busybody getting everything ready while Mary just sat at Jesus' feet and enjoyed the conversation, I don't know exactly why Martha ran out to meet Jesus and why Mary stayed back. I think maybe a little bit is Martha, she was always making sure preparations were ready. She wanted to go out and make sure that her guests felt welcome to come and just taking the extra steps, where Mary was just kind of laid back and people will come when they get here, we'll take care of that then. It's a little bit of the dynamic I feel like with my wife and I. She's always busy getting stuff ready and I'm kind of sitting around the house waiting for people to come. And I feel like she's angry at me for not doing anything. But I find it really interesting to look at this. Most people, when they read Mary, Martha's response, which we get the same response from Mary as well, they're going to verse 32. "Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." A lot of people think she's like chastising Jesus. This is no fault that Lazarus died. He should have been here. But I don't think that that's the case. I think she completely believed that Jesus could have saved Lazarus. And she understood that Jesus couldn't be there. She understood that they were trying to stone him. That's why he had left. And they waited, hoping that Lazarus would get better. The only example I can really think of here to relate this to is if I'm at work and something happens at the house, something breaks or whatever, and Carolyn tries to fix it, and this probably didn't happen, but she makes it worse, and then I come home and she's like, if you would have been here, this never would have happened. She knows that I had to be at work. She's not saying you shouldn't have been at work, you should have been at home. She knows that I could have taken care of it maybe in a better way. So I don't think that I think they're just stating the fact here that they knew Jesus could have prevented this from happening. But then also when she throws in there, but I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. I have to wonder, does Martha have in the back of her mind resurrection? Why would she throw that in? I don't know. I think that sometimes we may throw things out there. We believe God can do certain things, but we're not quite sure if he's going to or not. Verse 23, Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who has come into the world." After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here. He is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village. He was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary and in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went, they followed, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Martha reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. I looked at a lot of different versions. The New Living Translation says, "A deep anger welled up within Jesus." King James Version uses the word groan. And the Greek word for groan is to grunt angrily. So Jesus here is like, "Put them off." And I struggled with that for a while. I'm like, okay, you got all these people who are sad and crying, and Jesus is getting upset. I'm like, why? Why isn't he being sympathetic for these people and feeling sad with them? And I tell you what, the other week, I guess it was just 2, maybe 3 weeks ago, I experienced this myself. A friend of, or a hunting buddy of ours had passed away. He was 73. He had two heart attacks previously, so it wasn't a shocker. His last open heart surgery, they'd given him 15 years, and he was at 19 years, so he was kind of living a borrowed time there. And then that was Thursday or Friday, and Saturday was when Todd and Lady got admitted to Hershey, and Carolyn came and told me that, and it kind of ticked me off. I was upset, and because I was like, for Todd and Heidi, I was like, they don't deserve to go through this, and it just kind of ticked me off. And then all of a sudden, the light bulb went off, and I was like, I get it now. I wasn't angry at Todd and Heidi and at this hunting buddy passing away. I was angry at the circumstances that they had to go through, the pain that they had to go through, that this guy's family and that Todd and Heidi are going to have to experience through this. And I realized Jesus, he's angry at Satan here because of Satan bringing this pain and his sorrow and death to the people that he loves and that he cares about. You think about this, especially if you have mama bears here, if one of your kids or the rest of you, somebody who you really care about, best friend or a family member that you really care about and you love, if somebody physically or emotionally does something to them to hurt them, what do you want to do? You want to go kick some, you want to kick some butt, right? And that's what Jesus wants to do here. He's ready to throw down and show Satan what for. And then in verse 35, it says, how he loved them. See how Jesus loves you. He cares that much about you that when we're overcome by sin, sorrow, pain, it takes him long. And he's angry. He doesn't want us to have to experience that. But that's part of the ugly truth about life. Those are things that we're going to experience in a fallen world. Continuing on, verse 37, but some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Those got to have those people out there who have to kind of ruin the whole situation and tear others down and bring themselves up. Verse 38, Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, and he has been there for 4 days. I think here we have this mentioned again, Lazarus was dead for 4 days, and this is part of the significance of why Jesus waited 2 days before going back. The Jews held to a superstition that your spirit hung around your body 3 days, hoping for a resurrection. On the fourth day, the spirit left, so there's no more hope. So by Jesus waiting for the fourth day, he erases all possibility that it could have been anything other than God doing this work. Verse 40, then Jesus said, did I not tell you? Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God? Maybe I read into things a little bit too much, but I look at this and I think that for us sometimes when we are praying for certain things, like Martha here, she suggested in the very beginning that whatever you ask for, I know God will give you. And then here Jesus is going and he wants him to open it up. And I can understand, you know, she's been through enough already. Now she doesn't want to smell the stench of death on top of all that. But then Jesus says, didn't I tell you? Which suggests that there's some doubt there. Martha has some doubt that Jesus can raise Lazarus if that's what she believed in the very beginning. But Jesus still goes ahead and does this, and I think sometimes, you know, talks about when we pray, we need to believe, or we'll be like a ship tossed to and fro in a storm. I don't know if I got that exactly right, but I'll get into this a little bit more later, but I think it's okay to kind of struggle with whether or not we think when we pray, we need to believe that God can do it. Even though we don't know if he's going to do it. Verse 41, so they took away the stone, and Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, Jesus called out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and the cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. I think it's important to look at beyond this story a little bit. In verse 47 and 48, we have the Jews, the Pharisees, the chief priests, saying, what are we accomplishing? They asked. Here is this man performing many miraculous signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and then the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. All that they really cared about was their place, their power, and their place. And this is all political for them. They held a certain place of power, and Jesus is disrupting that. And if the people leave them and follow Jesus, they're going to lose all their power. They say this is key to who they are really worshiping. We will lose our place, they're referring to their temple, and our nation. So who's their God right there? It's themselves. It's all they care about. I think we need to be careful, though. It's easy to read this and judge them. I think we do this sometimes ourselves, don't we? Kevin last week challenged us a little bit in this as well about opening up and allowing the messiness of other people's lives to come in. I mean, sometimes we say, you know, we like our church the way it is. We don't want those people coming into our church and bringing their problems into our church. But it's not our church at all. It's God's church. And he intended it for it to be a hospital for the sick, not a bomb shelter where we go in, we close ourselves off from society and all of society's problems and messiness. I love this. We have this guy, Caiaphas, who is the high priest at this time. He's prophesying, and he doesn't even realize it. He says in verse 50, "Do you not realize that it is better for you for one man to die for the people than for the whole nation to perish?" He's talking about getting rid of Jesus so that they can hold their place of power politically. Little does he know that it is better for them for Jesus to die for all the people. I think it's funny how God will use things like that. I mean, his intentions are specifically for evil, and God's basically using him to prophesy here. In closing, I want to look at how we pray a little bit. I touched on this a little bit. I find it easy to read stories like this of Jesus doing miracles, healing people, raising Lazarus from the dead, and thinking that if I pray for some healing for someone and they're not healed, what did I do wrong? Did I not have enough faith? Did I not pray hard enough? Long enough? Should I have fasted? Could I have done more? And I've carried the guilt of other people not being healed from things because I felt like I screwed up. I didn't do enough. Because right here, I mean, we read all these stories about Jesus performing miracles and doing things, so why isn't he doing them now? Now, I do believe we take things, there's things that are, to me, are miracles that we take today. We just look at them in modern medicine, modern practices. For me, like a liver transplant is a miracle. Taking even a step further, a heart transplant. They can take somebody's heart out. I mean, just imagine, if your heart stops, you're dead. Okay? They can take somebody's heart out, put in someone else's heart in there, and the person can live. Hook everything back up, get it started going again. That's a miracle. Okay? But when we look at Martha here, and how she said, "I know that whatever you ask, God can give you." I think she knows that Lazarus can still be raised from the dead. But then when Jesus says, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" Jesus still raised Lazarus from the dead, even though she had doubt there that that was going to happen. So I think it's okay at times. I think what we need to do is not worrying about whether it's actually going to happen or not, just pray that it will happen and leave it up to God. He's going to decide. All these people that Jesus healed in the Bible, all the people that he raised from the dead, they're all dead today. That's an ugly fact of life of what we have to look forward to. Talk about my hunting buddies. Most of them are my dad's age, which is in their 70s. It's not a lot of fun hanging out with them because they talk about all the problems they have. And I'm like, man, this I don't know if I'm going to get old. But Hebrews 4:15 to 16 tells us that we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. And I don't think it's just talking about our weaknesses and how we fail and sin. I think it's talking about our weaknesses and how we are broken, frail human beings. Socrates said, "The love of Jesus does not separate us from the common necessities and infirmities of human life. Men of God are still men." And in Hebrews, it continues to tell us, "But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." So even if God chooses not to heal, I find it sometimes difficult to pray for healing because I'm afraid, especially publicly, you pray for healing and you don't get the healing, then you kind of feel like you're healed. Especially like I said, you know, sometimes I carry that guilt that I didn't pray hard enough, long enough, often enough. So then you become afraid to put yourself out there. But God's the ultimate deciding factor on what's going to happen. So we might as well just lay it all out on the line. In this story of John 11, Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead in verse 25, Jesus says, "He who believes in me will live even though he dies." So what do we have to lose? Let's just lay it all out on the line. Let's approach the throne of grace with confidence and courage and just pray with abandon and let God do the rest. We have a song. Oh, This is our time for prayer requests and sharing. So do you guys have anything? This is Remy Souter. You can remember Lisa in prayer on Friday. She's having surgery on her nose. It's a deviated septum. To make a long story short, we're going to make a pathway clear. This pathway that the air travels through is not open and bleeding, so they're going to open that up so she can breathe more easily. So just remember her in prayer on Friday.
This is Lisa Souter. Just an update on Jaden Pounce. We've been praying for him. He was in a serious car accident several weeks ago and was in LGH trauma unit. He is now, as of Friday, he moved to Hershey Rehab Hospital. There are 8 levels of coma, and he is at level 4 and needs to get to level 8. So just continue to pray for him and his family as he is on this road to recovery, and many doctors and nurses are very amazed at his progress and healing. And so I just believe that this is one event that can be for God's glory.
This is Dr. Musselman. Just a quick update on our daughter, Lydia. I believe she's in Palestine right now and just continue to have wonderful, great experience with her. Sometime next week, they're studying Arabic, working at an institute in Jerusalem. They're literally family in Palestine. And she said, the other Palestine I worked with, she said, their host reminded her of Grandpa Musser, Bob. Just a fun man to be with, some stories, and just see that that's how someone asked over there. But also getting exposed to probably a different view of the Middle East and cultural, yeah, racial tensions that we hear at the news over here. She's a deep person. She's taking a lot of this in. And her psychology, sociology, mindset, she's learning an awful lot about people. But if you need a pretty good story, though, she's had an experience like.
This is Michelle Bockway. A few weeks ago, I asked for prayer for Marilyn Lincoln. She passed away yesterday. I'd ask for prayer now for her husband and 5 sons and extended family. Are still there, but she's taking it day by day and is positive about things. My dad so far has not had any side effects from his medication, so I thank you for that. And he's just kind of plugging away his treatment, so thank you for your prayers.
Pray for quick recovery as well, Lord God, and healing over her. Lord, we just lift up Jaden to you as well. Thank you for the progress that he is making and the whether the nurses, they're surprised by the speed of his recovery. Just pray that they would see something else there, that you would use this for your glory, Lord God, as you have so many times through different struggles and situations. Just pray that you continue to heal his body, continue to restore him back to health, Lord God, and continue to give him encouragement and strength through that. God, we lift up Lydia to you as well. Thank you that her trip, the work that she is doing over there is helping her to grow. And we pray that it would continue to do that, and also that continue to impact those that she meets and interacts with. All for your glory, God. God, I just want to pray for Marilyn as well, or for her family, Lord, especially for her husband and their children through this difficult time for them, Lord God. Pray that you would bring individuals into their life to help out and encourage and support them, Lord. And just pray. We don't even know how to pray for situations like that sometimes, God, but we know that you know the hearts and minds of them and us as we pray, Lord God. We pray that you would intercede in ways that we cannot even think to pray, Lord God. And God, I just want to lift up Liz's parents to you. Thank you that so far everything has gone well. And we just pray that that would be the continued story here, that things would continue to go well. And Lord, I know it's think that it can be as much of a mind game going through those kind of things as well as physical. And so I just pray for your peace over the family. Pray for continued healing. Pray for continued positive reports on the treatment, Lord God, and on the side effects. And God, we just lift that up to you, lift them up to you, lift all these concerns up to you, God, even those that were not spoken here this morning. We pray for your glory, Lord God, to be used in each and every situation, and help us to be obedient to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God, I want to stand for the benediction. God, we thank you for each new day. Each new day is a blessing, Lord God, from you. To live as Christ, to die as gain. Be with us as we go from here, Lord God, to live that out. As we live, to have it be for you, God. And to know that when we die, as scary as that is, that it is to gain for us, Lord God, to enter into your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.